of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Father of all mercies and God of all consolation, come to the aid of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may attend to your word, confess our sins, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Redeemer.
Amen.
Let us make our confession to God. Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a troubled and penitent sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have offended you, and for which I justly deserve your punishment. But I am sorry for them, and repent of them, and pray for your boundless mercy, for the sake of the suffering and death of your Son, Jesus Christ. Be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Forgive my sins. Give me your Holy Spirit to live in my sinful life, and bring me to life everlasting. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. Through his Holy Spirit he cleanses us, and gives us power to proclaim the mighty deeds of God, who called us out of darkness into the splendor of his light. As a called and ordained pastor of Christ's church, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
break into our daily prayers, humble hearts, souls laid bare. You break in.
You break in.
You break in when defenses are down, with an angel shout or the quietest sound. You break in.
You break in.
O come, thou King of David, come, and open wide our heavenly home. Make safe the way that leads on high, and close the path to misery.
Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel. Come, come again, and with us ever dwell.
Reminded that time goes so quickly. Seems that we're just lighting the first candle and already the third. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Turn your ears to our prayers, O Lord, and illuminate our darkened minds by your glorious visit to the earth. You live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever.
Okay, we're going to be reading. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, then we were like those who dream.
Then was our mouth filled with laughter, and our tongues with shouts of joy.
Then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them.
The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad indeed.
Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the watercourses of the Negev.
Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy.
Those who go out weeping, carrying the seed, will come back again with joy, shouldering their sheaves. The epistle lesson comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Paul concludes this letter to the Thessalonians by encouraging them to live the lives of continual joy, prayer, and thanksgiving. The closing blessing is grounded in the hope of Christ's coming. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 24. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Jesus Christ for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. Now may God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. This is the word of the Lord.
I think it's probably to be very evident if we look around and think of ourselves that we are really a very fearful people. There are lots and lots of things in this day and age to which we can have fear. You know, looking in the scriptures, we find over and over again, in fact, we go back to Adam and Eve, well, the very first emotion that was expressed When Adam said, I was afraid. I was afraid. And you know, we look in the scriptures, and I just picked out a few passages just to see them. And when the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, the first thing he said was, do not fear. And then as he was talking to, or as Jesus was talking in the Sermon on the Mount, he said, fear not. And then the angel said to Zechariah, when he was appeared to Zechariah, he said, do not be afraid, Zechariah. Then the angel said to the woman at the tomb, do not be afraid. And then we think of the Joshua, as they were going into the promised land, and as Joshua was talking to the people, one of the things he said was, be not frightened. There are a lot of things in this day and age, aren't there, to be fearful of how things are going, and especially as we have to deal with the virus. So we have many, many things of which to be afraid. And it seems as though this is one of the chief things when Jesus was to come, and the promises of God was fear. Don't be afraid. Trust me. You know, and in this day and age, there are lots of voices. Lots of voices out there trying to ask you to trust them. You know, even in government, we find lots of voices around the world, here and there, the New Age religions and so forth, that want to speak to us in terms of don't be afraid. But who are we going to trust? What word are we going to trust? And too many of God's people, even those who claim to be Christians, are trusting, and partly because they don't know God's word. And so they're trusting other kinds of words. But who do we give the authority to that speaks to us and says, don't be afraid? You know, when I had my surgery, one of the things afterwards, the doctor was saying, now do this and that. Now, who am I going to give the authority to? Now, in this particular case, you know, we all give authority to different individuals in different situations. And so I gave the authority because this doctor, you know, for me to go out and listen to somebody or read something and then totally contradicts what the doctor says, that would be kind of foolish, wouldn't it? But we do, oftentimes, we go against what God's word says, the promises of God. And we want to solve our issues and solve our problems in our own way. But the question comes down, who do we really trust? What word do we finally trust as the word that speaks to us in all situations? And we hope and pray that our answer would be, you know, the word of God. You know, this is the Advent season, and it's almost coming to a close. The Advent season points to two things. It points to the birth of Jesus, and it points to the second coming of Jesus. And both of these ideas are involved, the birth of Jesus and the second coming of Jesus. And we find the threads of these two happenings throughout the Advent season. But we need to realize that Advent, or rather the birth of Jesus, was not just a sentimental happening. Now we know this, but I know when we celebrate it in our homes, it's often very nice and peaceful, and you know, we look at situations like this, and it looks all nice and peaceful, but it really wasn't, was it? And see, the birth of Jesus was really a continuation of the battle. And we need to realize that we are still in that battle. God began that battle as best we could see when he called Abraham. And then events kept going on for many years before the fullness of time had come. And we need to realize that we are in a battle against the forces of evil. And the birth of Jesus was just another event, another happening, as God was bringing about the reality of what we saw in Isaiah, those first few verses. I want to read those first few verses again in Isaiah, because they're happy verses. They're promising verses. just the first few. Notice it says, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me, first of all, to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prisons of those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant those who mourn in Zion, to give them a beautiful headdress instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit. You're going to hear a little bit more about that later, the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit that God, by the Holy Spirit, puts in our spirits. But we see with Mary and Joseph, this was not a joyful time in a certain sense. When Mary was about due to have a baby, and they couldn't find any place to have a baby. Couldn't have any bed to lay in. Those of you who are mothers, can you think about it? If this time had come for you to give birth, and there was no place to go. You were out in the wilderness and nothing to do. What could you do? Well, this is the way it was with Mary and Joseph. They did find a place. They did finally find a place. But it wasn't too long after that, was it? When Herod was out to get Jesus, Herod had a misunderstanding of what it meant when they said Jesus was king. And so Herod was out to kill all the little babies, figuring in the process he's going to get Jesus. And so here are Mary and Joseph, not too long after she had given birth, and they were still in a difficult situation. Now they had to take off and flee because the baby Jesus was about to be slain. So they had to travel clear over to Egypt. The next thing, they have to come back. Well, they finally end up in Nazareth. But we see that it wasn't a sentimental, easy, peaceful event. We see the birth of Jesus. And the time had fully come. See, when the time, the fullness of time had come, God sent his only son, Jesus, to continue this battle. This battle that we are all involved in because of the struggles we have. You know, when we confess our sin at the beginning of the service, you know, we see the battle there. And we pray, Lord, to help us in our sinful life to win the battle in this great struggle that we're in. Because we are in the battle, and the battle still rages on. Since the time of Jesus and the crucifixion and the resurrection, the battle has continued. And now we as God's people are involved in this battle that we might win the victory through Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Because there are lots of things that would bring us down, aren't there? Now, our own pride, our resentments, our anger, our selfishness, our thinking that we don't really measure up. Because sometimes I think when our young people in school, you know, they oftentimes will have struggled with, they don't really measure up. They don't really fit in. And we all can have that sense of feeling in a certain way. And it's amazing sometimes the things people will do, the kind of things they will get involved in order to somehow feel that they measure up, somehow feel that they're making it okay. And sometimes it affects them the rest of their lives. Well, one of the things God provided for when Jesus was when Jesus ascended unto the Father, as we're waiting, we're in the church, we're still waiting. We're waiting for Jesus to come again. Now, we don't think about that very often, do we? And we aren't too involved in the fact of Jesus coming again. But he invites us into his church, that we wait together, that we worship together. And that's so important. And then he was looking at Thessalonians. There's three things that we can see, if you remember in Thessalonians, that are true about the church. What we hope is true about the church, and hopefully true about each one of us. First Thessalonians, rejoicing. He says, rejoice always. We as the church are to be the rejoicing people of God. And then he goes on to say, pray. Pray always. And we are a praying church. And we get lots of things on the email, and you know, pray. Pray for her, pray for him, pray for this, pray for that. And that's what we are to do. We are to be a praying church. We are to be a rejoicing church and a praying church. And then lastly, a grateful church. Give thanks in all circumstances. Now that's a difficult one, isn't it? But that's what the scripture says. We are to be a rejoicing church, a praying church, and a grateful church, that we give thanks in all circumstances. And that's not easy for us, but that's the calling upon our lives. And we see in this text, in 1 Thessalonians, I want to remind us again, where it said where Jesus is coming again. He says, in this particular, it said, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. This isn't part of our waiting. We are to be sanctified. We are to be living for Jesus, to use that expression. And may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because sometimes we may have a difficult time. It has been 2,000 years approximately since Jesus was ascended unto the Father. And we hear about Jesus is coming again. And sometimes we may have a difficult time really, you know, getting with that and finding joy. Yeah, he's maybe going to come tomorrow. So I better be ready. But there are things that happen, aren't there, that we aren't expecting, that we need to be ready. We need to be ready. We need to be seeking blamelessly, or to be blameless. You know, I think of, and you're aware of the fact of what happened with our son Paul. Just like that. Just like that. He's gone. And many things, and many of you have had different kinds of experiences. Now, Corinne is here this morning. She had a similar experience with Ron. But there, all of a sudden, no warning, no chance. And so, there are many reasons, many things that can happen that we need to be ready. And Corinne, have you got a thought to share about that?
Well, since you asked me, I have been thinking about it a lot. And surrounded by people, you know, who have gone through this. It is so important to have those conversations. And that's what I'm so thankful in this difficult circumstance that Ron and I were able to have conversations before he died, because our good friend was dying of cancer. Would that have happened? Would we have had those discussions? Maybe not. But it was a blessing that God, you know, gave to us, to me particularly. And give me that sense of peace. And also, as you mentioned, this place that we come to, that you can look in people's eyes that have gone through the same thing, and you support and pray with us, and or pray with me. And I think we just said about the Word of God, you know, how important it is to be in the Word and to know that God, and to trust that God is there for me, for all of us who have gone through this.
Thank you. Be ready. There's lots of good reasons, and there are several here who have had experiences. Maybe not the same, because each experience is a little bit different. But it was hurtful. It was painful. And so we need to be ready, because this is the kind of world we're living in. When Jesus came to birth, although we kind of sentimentalized world in which to live. And so today we still have this difficult situation. And our response, when I mentioned that I was going to go back to this psalm, or this Isaiah passage, the garment of praise. The garment of praise. I think a lot of us don't realize, I didn't realize this really until too long ago, that there's more about praise in the Bible than there is about prayer. And we talk a lot about prayer, and well, we should. But I think we probably are on the side of praise where we probably don't get into praise, really praising God as much as we could or should. Praising God. Notice he said, the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit. The garment of praise, praising God in all circumstances, instead of a faint spirit. A faint spirit that wants to give up. A faint spirit that wants to say, what's the use? A faint spirit that says, God, why did you allow this to happen? A faint spirit that questions the word of God, that questions his love and his mercy. And so we can have that faint spirit. But Isaiah is saying to have a garment of praise, being clothed with a garment of praise to God. You know, I'm sure that most of us, not all of us, have sung the doxology many, many times. It's a great hymn. But I didn't know this until recently, that the doxology was written way back in the 1700s. In the 1700s, this man came up with the doxology. And this doxology has been sung probably more than any other of the songs that we sing. And there are still churches today who every time they close their service, they sing the doxology. You'll praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. This is a garment of praise that God calls us to praise him as we worship him and praise him in all circumstances, which calls upon us to reach out and to trust God and to trust his word. I would just like to ask us, let's sing a verse of the doxology. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Let's just go ahead and sing. Let's start out, sing.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
It says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering.
Let us hold fast.
Do we get a hold of this as our hope in Jesus as Lord and Savior? The hope that comes through the birth of Jesus and on to the crucifixion and resurrection. It says, for he who promised is faithful. God keeps his word. As we read it in the scriptures, he who promised is faithful. And so then he speaks to the body and he says, and let us stir up one another to love and good works. So let us consider ways that we can stir up one another. One time this person's having a difficult time, and another time somebody else is having a difficult time. But the thing is, we can stir up one another, encourage one another, because that's what we need in this kind of a battle that we're involved in. And Amy says, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some. Some just don't come around, do they? Not neglecting that, but doing our very best to come together and worship him. But encouraging one another. And all the same, as you see the day drawing near. So encouraging one another. I know more than one of us have just been encouraged by the body. I know myself with Paul was really encouraged by the body. And so the body, we need to praise God for the body. We need to praise God for joy. We need to praise God that we are part of this people of God. As we fight together, as we battle together, as we have the victory in Jesus as our Lord and as our Savior. Amen. Let's join in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we know, and you know so well, that the battle is tough. We are in this battle, but we know that through the power of the Holy Spirit, through our faith and our commitment, knowing that Jesus is Lord and our Savior, that we are victorious in this battle. Help us more and more, Lord, to learn to praise you, for all circumstances, to know that you are God, to know that you keep your promises and you are faithful. And so we pray that we may, day by day, continue to pray and to praise. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.
Amen.
Wait just one moment. I forgot one thing. I don't know why I forgot it. There's a song that it's got a great message to it. And we sung this song, or not sung it, heard it a few months back. But then somehow the speaker system wasn't working for the first service. And so those at the first service didn't get to hear it, but just at the second service. But I'd just like if we'd just sit back and listen to the words as we hear this song being sung.
Like
when life's at its best. Now it's down the valley. Trials and temptations, that's where your faith is really put to test. For the power of the mountain is still God in the valley.
will find comfort, and captives to sin and death experience your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Restore the fortunes of Christians who are persecuted for confessing Jesus as Lord. Turn their weeping into rejoicing. Cause those who hate them to repent and believe in the good news. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless and guide the people of this congregation. Give us faithful hearts, ears attentive to your word, eyes which see the needs of others, hands skilled in building up the body of Christ, and tongues swift to pray, forgive, and encourage. Look up with favor upon the North American Lutheran Church, our Southwest Mission District, our sister congregation, and upon your missionaries around the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide and strengthen our seminarians and all considering your call to serve the church. Make them faithful, true, and bold, and let them find joy in your service. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Anoint the rulers of the world with your spirit, so that, like you, they love justice and hate evil. Use them to repair lives and cities ruined by violence. Direct their words and their works in your truth. Establish your peace among the nations. Make each of us into trees of righteousness and the planting of the Lord, bearing much fruit to your glory and for the building up of your people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Until your great and acceptable day has gone, good people must risk their lives for the sake of justice, liberty, and safety. Shield, strengthen, and direct them. Help them to serve with competence and integrity. Keep them from harm. Heal and raise them when they falter. Give them a joyful reunion with their loved ones when their task is done. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant your healing to the brokenhearted and to all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, especially those we name in our hearts. Give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, and the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Strengthen all who care for them, and give them and all of us your everlasting joy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Most Holy Father, we entrust to your care all who have died, trusting your promises. Thank you for the lives. Thank you for making them and us your servants, a royal priesthood and holy nation, your children and portion whom you have blessed. Bring us into the beauty of Holy Zion, where with all the redeemed we shall be adorned as a bride for our heavenly bridegroom, the Lamb of God, who has taken away the sin of the whole world. Our Lord Jesus Christ, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Graciously answer our prayers for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit reigns one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We praise your name and we join their unending hymn.
Yeah.
body of Christ. Take and drink. This is the blood of Christ. Now may the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, and his precious blood, strengthen you and preserve you until life everlasting. Peace be with you. Amen.
Bringing this basket up here.
On behalf of Joy Women, the joyful women here at Joy, we put this welcome basket together for Pastor Randy and Robbie. So please, we welcome you, and we hope it's full of joy. Lots of fun things in here, and hopefully things to help you with your new house as you guys are moving in this coming Friday. So lots of joy.
It looks like heavy joy.
It is very heavy. So we want to welcome you and
goodness.
Thank you. Lots of treats for your new house.
Thank you. I'm going to take a point of personal privilege and thank each and every one of you for your prayers. The 40 days of prayer have touched us deeply and gotten us through some difficult times trying to get our house. But it's done now, and we take possession of it Monday evening, and we move all of our stuff in on Friday, as was said. And also, we want to thank all those who provided meals at a time when All of our pots and pans are in a box. And so much love has been shown us. And I love having met this wonderful man here at our ministry Thursday and getting to know him better. You have had some good shepherds in your pastoral absence, and I rejoice in that, and I rejoice in all of you. My love is growing each day for the people, the saints of joy. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
Any other announcements? We will close with our post-communion canon.
Peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.